Hello, Miss Crane. It is an honor and a privilege to meet you. Could you please say your full name and place of residence to the camera?
Marion Crane, and I am from Phoenix, Arizona.
Great, thank you, Marion. Can you tell me a little bit about yourself?
Well, I work for Mr. Lowry at a real estate office in the area. I do his bookkeeping there.
Great, so let's dive right in. Marion, I hope you don't mind me being so crude, but are you aware how absolutely iconic your death is in the film industry?
So I've heard today.
You opened up discussions about gender, sexuality, Catholic morality and retribution, and modern storytelling. How does that make you feel?
Well, I can't say I feel much about it, Drew. It's hard to laud death as something to be celebrated.
Right. Sorry.
No harm done.
Many people are curious about why you took money. Care to comment?
I think it's very obvious why I took the money.
Because you felt trapped in a relationship going nowhere and a job you hated, and you finally saw a way out, so like the bird of your namesake, you flew the coop, if you pardon the expression?
Something like that.
And before the, well, you know, you did plan on returning the money, yes?
Yes, I had planned to return to Phoenix the next morning.
Why?
Well, I don't know if you've ever heard of a tortured conscience, Drew, but it's something not so easily swayed.
And that tortured conscience led you to return $40,000 you've already successfully stole? I guess, Miss Crane, what I'm trying to get at is, well, did you go back because of a tortured conscience, or did you go back because you were afraid of getting caught?
I suppose I never thought of those two things as separate. Well, an element of my tortured conscience believed that I would eventually get caught.
And what did the other element believe?
That I couldn't do it.
Couldn't do what?
Live the rest of my life alone. I mean, you saw Norman. He was quite the tortured soul.
And you think it was because he lived alone?
I know it was. You saw it yourself. I could feel myself losing my mind after just mere hours of being alone with my own thoughts. I can't even imagine what years alone must feel like, and I really didn't want to know.
Wow. So Norman convinced you to go back?
I suppose just not in the way you might expect.
I guess not.
So, what else do you have for me, Drew?
Well, I wanted to know a little more about the shower scene, but I understand that that's a bit of a sore subject for you.
Please, by all means.
Well, many regard it as an almost rape scene, the idea of the translucent veil of dignity being penetrated by this menacing foreign object. Can you speak a bit to that moment?
Well, I wasn't feeling much else but dread, Drew, but I have spoken with many reporters today who have been saying the same thing. And I do believe that people see what they want to see and believe what they'd like to believe. Ultimately, my death means absolutely nothing without the view of the voyeur, anyway, looking into my life so privately.
Now, when you refer to the voyeur, do you mean director Alfred Hitchcock?
Something like that. And anyway, people would have seen absolutely nothing without him.
You're right about that. Now, Miss Crane...
You can call me Marion.
Okay, Marion. That brings me to my final question. Almost all of Hitchcock's blondes seem to be victims of the circumstances their male protagonists get them in. You break the mold in this way.
I could say that.
So, could you say that you were the first real feminist portrayal of a woman in the Hitchcock canon? We've seen women's empowerment before in many of the films, but this was really the first time you operated outside of the male sphere created by the male protagonist of Hitch.
Gotten the chance to view some of the other films, and I wouldn't say that I'm the first portrayal of feminism in Hitch's work. I may have more independent qualities, but feminism is everywhere in Hitchcock.
So, then, you would consider Hitchcock's films about misogyny as opposed to being misogynistic?
Suppose you could say that, yes. Cool.